Science for Sculpture is a 35-acre sculpture park and museum that has captured visitors' imaginations since 1992. Since becoming a public nonprofit in the year 2000, we've watched as our visitor numbers have grown and more people have come and discovered our tranquil setting and engaging art. Indoor exhibits of emerging and well-known artists are shown throughout the year in two expansive glass-walled buildings that were once exhibit halls for the New Jersey State Fair. Over 200 contemporary sculptures, from monumental to smaller scale, can be found outdoors on the beautifully landscaped grounds. Grounds for Sculpture also offers gardens, water features, an exciting restaurant, Rats, a cafe, museum shop, Toad Hall shop and gallery, and a seasonally open gazebo cafe for visitors. Educational programs and special events are scheduled throughout the year, offering lectures, hands-on art activities for adults and children, tours, music, community events, and more. Patrick Dougherty's site-specific sculptures are made by weaving tree saplings into large organic constructions that have been described as nests, cocoons, and haystacks. The concept begins with a visit to the location where drawings and ideas are formulated based on the physical and social qualities of the site. At Grounds for Sculpture, Patrick's vision included tower-like forms that creep up the stairs and form intimate spaces that can be entered, then flow down into a swirling, interlocking system of shells and nests before emptying their energy into vessels, giving a sense of movement and fluidity through the museum. This was a unique experience for both Grounds for Sculpture and the artist. We had never had the opportunity to involve so many members of our community in the construction of a sculpture in this way, and they were very eager to get involved. The educational impact of having an artist available to speak with our visitors and allow them to see him working and even assist him in building the sculpture was very exciting.
Yeah, that's one of the good advantages of working in a place that you, you know, and if you're helping me, you might have to answer the questions for me after a while. Because, you know, viewers are really always interested in what you're doing, how you're building it, what your ideas are. And a lot of times if you're just a plain exhibition, they don't get their curiosity answered at all. They come in, they don't know what, you know, they just look at it. It's got not as much depth to it as if they've gotten to talk to you or talk to somebody about it.
Well, that's really exciting groups, I think.
And this is really a target audience because these folks know they're coming to a sculpture place. So, you know, that'll be even more fun. Like if you catch people on a street corner, sometimes they're kind of flummoxed by the thing. They're like, what are you doing? I'm calling the police, you know. Yeah, you're out here, you're doing what? I don't believe you.
Patrick had never had such a large time frame in which to work on one project. And since the sculptures have a relatively short lifespan, generally about 2 years, this exhibition also represents a kind of retrospective for him.
My son Sam, he's 10 years old, and he has a children's book about three bears that encounter urban sprawl. And these bears go up over a hill near their house one morning, and they look down, and somebody's built a shopping center overnight. Well, already people are hustling and bustling up and down the sidewalk, and they all look so satisfied. Well, the little bears, they're not sure they're happy anymore. And somewhere they find people clothes. In the next sequence of pictures, you see these little pint-sized figures moving amongst the legs of all the other passers-by. And your caption reads, well, now that they're like everybody else, are they really happy? I said, well, no, not really, because underneath their people clothes still beat their furry little animal hearts. Well, the big wind comes up, and it blows, and it blows. It blows men's ties out, women's skirts up. It blows all the little bears' clothes off. And for the first time, they realize who and what they really are. So they get tearing back across the parking lot, back to a place they could be themselves. And it hadn't been so many years ago as a crow flies that I was getting ready for work. I had a coat and tie on and a briefcase. I start down my walkway and a really big wind came up. And it blew and it blew, and the first gust blew my briefcase right down the street. The second blew off my coat and tie, and the third blew everything else away. as I'm standing there, completely amazed at this unlikely turbulence in my life, the only thing I can feel is this thudding of an animal heart under my people clothes. And I remember, and I had flashbacks to all the times in my childhood that all I could think about was maybe giving up my normal life, going off into the distance, building a small cabin, and living in a more essential way.
We're checking the floor. We have our heating system in the floor here, and we need to drill in the floor to anchor the sculpture in a couple places, so we have to make sure we're not drilling on a line. Is that actually disastrous? So they're using an infrared camera to find out where the radiant heat pipes go.
I always flex these sticks a little bit, and I pull them through the matrix, and that's how I put the whole thing together. As I said in my lecture, I usually work structurally first. I build a kind of a structure that can take sticks. In this case, we've had kind of elaborate use of scaffolding. We put the scaffolding around it. Since we couldn't go into the floor, we would build the thing, and then we'd pull the scaffolding out and leave the piece standing there. And then once I've got a structure, I work aesthetically on it. In other words, I make a kind of drawing on there, and I use a lot of the conventions of drawing to enliven the surfaces, and that's what carries the burden of the illusions in these things. Many times it's these blind lines at the top.
Sculptures like this that you can go in fancies, or there's a pretty term.
Follies.
Follies
in Princeton right now.
Yeah, this would be a little bit like a folly.
We were living in Savannah, and they did the whole city.
I did the piece down the park.
Yeah. You did?
It's not in here, but...
Oh, how great. Yeah. So we've seen your work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I did a piece on the wall of Habersham Hall. I don't think it's in here either.
Oh.
But it was a big wall piece that was on the old county jail there.
Yes, I remember. It was fabulous.
Oh, well, thank you.
Oh, yes. And in Forsyth Park, you did a piece?
In Forsyth Park as well.
How long did I last?
Well, a lot of times they're up for the life of the show, like they are here. But eventually, inside you. Most everything I do is temporary work. It's meant to last a certain short period of time. And I capitalize on spaces that are temporary, a business or someone, Arboretum could allow a piece to be in their lobby for a certain period of time, and then they couldn't have it there forever.
Do you spray something on them?
We'll put fire retardant on these at the end to reduce the fire hazard. It really doesn't protect it. It just is just a fire retardant. If you do too much spraying of a surface thing, it changes the color so dramatically that it doesn't, kills all the grays and makes it look wet all the time. So
no.
I think you just have to accept that it's temporary.
How many are you doing in here?
I'm going to do a big one that sits down in that end, and then a set that works over in this area and around the way there.
Oh, yeah, how long is it
really going to tell the whole place?
It'll take you 3 months to truly work the whole piece.
Well, you have a lot of work to do, and I don't want to
help
you
anymore. Yeah, thank you all. I really appreciate it. Yeah, bye. I used to dream that, but I don't dream it anymore because every time I'd close my eyes, I'd see sticks, but I managed to block it now. I don't know how that happened, but I'm able to stop thinking about it. Well, I appreciate it. We really need it. The thing about this, and it's been so great for me, is that I can do work here inside that I could never do anywhere else, because if you put something in an outside public park, there's no supervision. People have no ideas about how to use it. They don't even know if it's sculpture or whether it's a piece of playground equipment. And so I've been able to make much more tentative work that has some real subtleties that I wouldn't be able to probably build into an exterior space that is in a public situation. So for me, this has been absolutely fantastic, and everything has gone so perfectly well for me. We've had help gathering the materials. We had this huge volunteer force that helped us take the leaves off. We've had a constant stream of volunteers to come and help us detail and do some of this work. And so, overall, we are really been ahead of schedule, and And it's just been a fantastic situation for me. This is the first time that I've done something over 3 months or done enough work to fill a big space. So I think of it as kind of a retrospective in my own way, that there's some of the conventions that I've learned over the years, I've been able to play out into these works. And certainly all this material is drying and getting stronger all the time. So it loses a lot of water, it gets much lighter, and it gets very much stiffer. And so that's what I'm relying on, and with my fingers crossed like this, that as the thing dries, it'll stiffen up and really hold itself. So that's kind of, and then in terms of talking about the way that the thing ended up in this space, one thing is that when you're doing a really big group of pieces, what I'm finding is that you need to vary the show some, because you don't want every single piece in this place to look the same. You never have that problem if you're just building one piece, but when you're building a number of pieces. So one of the things I started out thinking was that I would build a kind of an architectural piece, because some of my work has been a bit architectural. So some of it might be a big teapot or something, but that's still...
What happened to the battery goes dead?
It always goes down.
So Maggie, what's your take on the project so far?
Well, it's very exciting that it's progressing, you know, so quickly. We started with pretty much just tape on the floor, so it's been kind of amazing at the rate that it's been going. But I have to say that having the different volunteers come and help has been really like sort of helping us move through the project a lot faster. So it's been good. It's been very exciting, and I'm getting better as far as handling these trees, not as beat up, but it's good. It's good.
Did you get a lot accomplished in the last couple of days?
I think today we've got a lot of our doors outlined, and we've got this rim put on here. And I'll continue to go back and to work on the body of it and to try to make it more exciting all the time. At a point, there won't be any more I can do to it. But at the moment, I think that there's still some things that I could do to kind of spruce it up and make it look a little more exciting. I'm using some of these maples to outline the doorway a little bit, because they're a bit more flexible and give a sense of twisting and motion, so I'll probably do a little bit more of that.
Now, I noticed in one of your other pieces you have the similar type of rim that's running. What's your idea on that?
Well, one thing is, I thought that since I'm committed to making a piece of architecture, that you have the sense that it was the second floor, the first floor, and just mocking it up with there's a sense that by just having this kind of line, just make a suggestion that it's a kind of architecture of some sort. So it was, also the way that it cuts in underneath the balcony here will give it a sense of continuity. It won't look like this is a kind of, is a real divide. There'll be this way that your eye will follow around and assume that this is kind of a solid unit, and you'll forget about the corner going into it, and when you get up there, you'll be able to see how the corner interacts with the sculpture, and you'll be able to stand out in that area and look into the sculpture itself, be actually inside from the upper balcony, which is the kind of hit that I was getting from it, the idea of building something here at the corner that you could stand at the second level of the sculpture and actually look in it and see what it's like up there. Top object and making it into a kind of an architectural thing, you know, like a building that you could go in, a little teapot you could go inside as a building, like a tea house or so. So, but anyway, I wanted to make a piece of architecture, and I wanted to make it tall because I decided I would slip it into the corner of the balcony there so that I could use the balcony, and there's a steel post in there that holds the balcony up, and there's the steel girders that are underneath the balcony, and all those were employed as a kind of an intertwining device, the railings upstairs. And so what that allowed is not only could you go in the base of it, but you could walk into the corner of it upstairs and kind of get another view of people activating the space downstairs as they walk in. You know, you're like, whoa, look at those people down there, or you see them above and they're standing on the railing. So sometimes you can use just your viewers to interest other people at looking at something.
Uh-huh. Where did you learn this kind of construction?
I'm making it up as I go.
Oh, awesome. You've been somewhere where people make shelters this way.
Well, anybody that uses sticks or any animal, they end up playing by the same rules because there's certain things they'll do and certain things they won't do. So what I would like you to do is like, you're blending even from over into here, into this, you know. I mean, what'll happen is you can reach out over there and go as far as you can and then come into here. And it's got to kind of stop in the doorway somewhere. So, and these will, I'll put more lines out here to catch it, and just like the edge of a wall or a window frame, you just kill your lines down in here.
Okay.
And then on this side, what's happening, the lines are going this way, the lines are going that way here. And right now, we built an understructure first, so the lines go everywhere. Try to get them in the wall, and so you can take and push them down in the middle of the wall and fold them back. Try, and anything that you see that you can force back like that, you can kind of keep, try to force it into a flat.
So essentially we're just trying to,
you kind of fill it.
Yeah, in this wall.
And see, you've got these things and you can run them. You can run them down through the wall. They're just gnarly as the devil, but you can just work at it. See how you can stab them through there and then pull them down in the middle of the wall. That's right. So just do that a while. And so that they don't end up being at the exact same spot, they don't all end and break at the same time. So there's two sides to every story. So you can take one side and then you can switch off.
And this one, please.
And we can talk about how you can do it better or something, but even if I talk myself blue in the face,
you don't have to mess with it. I understand. This is sort of, all right, here we are. Good.
Like, one kid had his mouth open, like, I thought a bird was going to fly in there. He was so excited about the project, and all the little kids, like, running around and asking Patrick all these questions, and, you know, how'd you make these sticks bend this way, and they're really fascinated by it, so that was kind of cool, so.
Well, it's like fork building for kids.
It is, I mean, and another thing is that, you know, they come with their school groups, and I handed out the flyers, you know, the Ground True Sculpture Patrick Dougherty flyers, and the kids, I mean, they just love it, and they're going to go back and bring their parents here and sort of getting them to enjoy this as well. So I think that's a good thing. It appeals to everybody, no matter what experience you have in art, you're still going to like it. So it's good stuff.
Everybody likes art. You know? Sometimes they don't know that they do.
That's actually kind of true, but this is, I think, something, I mean, it's a material that everybody has had contact with. As a kid, you know, you've played with sticks, you've done stuff with sticks, treehouse, tree forts, anything, and it's a material that people can relate to.
Your job is to tighten everything up,
right? Yeah, to kind of finish off the borders and stuff like that. So I've worked on this and hiding the wires and the rebar underneath here, so just kind of disguising it. So that's what I've been working on.
This is 169.
Wow.
That's pretty good, isn't it?
You feel that they get a little better every time you do them?
I do get better.
No, I mean, just...
And I get used to working with worse material. To do something even though maybe years ago I would have failed if I tried to use this material. I would have been crying and saying I couldn't do it. This drawn surface, or this kind of, what I try for is a kind of line logic where I'm using the sticks in one direction, and so the sticks are tapered, and so if you compile the sticks in a certain mass and stick them all in one direction, it has a sense of movement. And then there's a lot of types of ways of X-ing things that make it also have a sense of hopping.
My sort of expertise, finishing off the bottoms of these sculptures and sort of getting to make sure that it looks like there's nothing, like the supports, hiding the vertical supports and all that other good stuff, kind of hiding that and making it look like it's not really supported by anything. same stuff I've been doing downstairs. One of the volunteers is doing the same thing. She's finishing off the end so it looks nice and smooth, and it has like a nice, sits nicely on the floor. So it's found that it's very, I've started developed like a little style to it. I have a certain type of stick that I like to use and that kind of stuff. So it's nice for slow work. So it takes a long time to get one little corner done, but I hope it's good.
So you're developing a style?
I think so. I mean, it's weird. When I first started, like any stick looked like any stick, but you start to look at it and you start to develop, you know, which stick you like to use and the flexibility. So I've been learning a whole lot actually. So it'll be interesting to see what the second phase of the project and the third phase of the project will bring. So be good.
So there are, at the very end, their director was the only one breaking.
Email me all the time, so you feel free.
And you're going to email me so I can send out the stuff.
Huh?
I'm going down.
You're going to add a skylight to your roof?
Yeah, I am. And I'm just going to see what it would be like to bend these over so that I can...
Of course, here people are arriving and they really have a predisposition for sculpture, which is fantastic. Rarely have I ever been anywhere that actually people came to just look at sculpture. So that's been another very illuminating situation where people are talking to you and conversing with you about sculpture because they know something about it. So I wanted to do an architectural piece, and then in contrast, I wanted to do something that had some rough edges. So the piece upstairs on the far balcony is a bit of a nest looking thing with a lot of fringing and rough edges, and also I wanted to you to be able to preview something happening up there because of that big, long, open space. I tied it into the rafters there so you can see it from below. And also when you walk up to the door outside and it's at night, you just see this big thing up there. So it kind of starts pulling the whole architecture, the whole show together. And then I moved towards this piece down here, which is based on just a bit of automatic writing where I was taking and making kind of a doodle on the on a piece of paper like you would next to the telephone, and then decided, oh, I would make a kind of a rough circle with three loops out and two loops in, or maybe it's the other way around, but we laid that out in tape on the floor and then just saw what the results might be. So my overall style of working is just a kind of a reactive style. I know the overall feeling that I wanted to have. I know that tower has got to be tall to be the tallest thing in the show, so that if I can, but it's attached to the railing, so I have one big tall architecture.
So I'm not really tied to any one material or any really.
I'm really talking a lot, aren't I?
Yeah.
Well, I'm working on the roof. I've got to put these up. I'm making vertical pieces that go around the top of the roof so that it will distinguish the roof from the surrounding area, because from a distance the roof looks just like a continuation of, as without the rounded parts, it looks just like a continuation of the wall from downstairs. So in order to just make it distinctive, I'm putting these verticals on it. It takes a lot of time, but anyway, I think it's worth it. I have to clean some of the excess off here because I love the way these things look sticking straight up, but they're going to be kind of in the way in the sense that they're going to block the view of the dome. And so in any one piece, you can't have everything. I'm going to calm them down, even though I like them. Ironically, people give you advice the whole time you're working, and they see something and they hope it won't ever change. So that you can't possibly cut these things from around the edge. They look too good. And then you're kind of like, oh my God, maybe they're right. Maybe I shouldn't cut them. Maybe you can leave a couple.
Well, I think I will actually work.
and it's all said and done, I'll go back and fix up in a way that will look good, whatever that is. First started thinking about it in 1982.
Is this something you saw that gave you the idea to do this? Or?
Well, I live in a log cabin, so it was not that far from. So I knew a lot of it. And I've always liked the woods, and I wanted to work in a way of working. I've done a lot of log cabin work myself, to thinking about using the tops of the sticks and stuff is another way that I knew, some way that I already felt like I was aware of how to do it without having to learn too much. And ironically, you might say, well, how would you know about sticks? But I feel like everybody knows about sticks. It's a backyard material that comes that you have to cut down and move around, and when you were a child, you learned how to play with it and make things out of it. And when you went through your building phase as a child, you always used sticks. And so, you know, it's something that it's our first building material as a human. People have probably been using sticks for longer than any other building material, maybe clay, because of the availability of it. So ubiquitous that it was easy to get hold of and easy to use. So I just capitalized on the things I might already have inside somewhere, some ideas. And then as things go along, you have other ideas based on, once you get a starting point, then the materials and just the act of working with them is just promotive, and it gives you ideas about what else to do. And oh, I could try to do this, and I could try to do that. People talk to you, and you learn from what they say to you. They talk about their experiences in the woods, and they tell you what they think, the significant moments of their life. They stand there, and you're working on your stick work, and they're telling you all this stuff about their lives, and that, oh, we had this best tree in the world. It was Big Mr. Twister. It was down in the swamp. We all went down there and played on it every day, you know. So those kind of things, you know, they allow you to realize that the material has potential power for the viewer, just because of the inherent associations that go with the material. They become meaningful. And so, you know, my audience informed me about the value of the work and how to do it. And it's just always inventiveness. People invent things as they go, and so I'm good at that. Dyslexic and left-handed. In fact, I learned to build log cabins out of them. I sat down with the box iron book and for 1 week learned how to cut corners until I could cut all the different times, learned them right out of that book. And part of my basic assumption is that we all know about sticks, that we played with them in our childhood. If you see kids go through their construction phase, they know instantly what a stick can do. It's a huge utility. We've cut them out of our backyards, and you know, we just know a lot about them. We almost have a genetic predisposition for them because the sticks were our first building material. So, in the very distant past, hunting and gathering meant really gathering up what was ever available and using it. So, we've really got that down. And somewhere this reminisces with those and calls to those distant feelings that are buried somewhere in us as humans. We've had a number of great school groups that have come through, and so I'm sure you'll get more. But they're great because they really, we have a picture or something. Look at that! You know, it's like, that's what makes it worth it, you know, because you really feel like you've connected on some essential level with the viewer. You know? And the kid in us all, I guess. And so that's the basis of success and failure that I really
thing. You know, is it too hackneyed? Does it look like Disneyland? Where are the cut lines between being, you know, too prim, too this, too that? Very reactive in what I do. Like, I'll set some kind of an idea up like I did with this doodle first, and then trying to imagine what each of these little loops on the doodle meant. I started with the front one there, and I learned some things, this front cabana thing. I learned some things there, and then I started saying, well, how would this one, this next one go? Would it lean into that, or would it lean away from that? And part of that was achieved when we had our scaffolding up. We pull the sticks one way, and then we worked on them, and then we pulled them back the other way, and then we worked on them so that we were freezing a part of the form, and then had some tendrils up there, then we pull those tendrils back. And so, you know, by pulling them back and forth, we got more gesture into the work. So a lot of that is just experience, and then also just being able to react. One of the things that's really one of my best qualities is to be able to react really fast to things, and to look at something and just make snap judgments without very much deep thinking about it, and just cruise along on it. And in other words, I capitalize on opportunity. So all of them, they tend to, you know, lean different directions, and it gives a sense of a shucking and jiving in a way. You know, they're kind of, you know, moving. And
how's the project going?
It's going along really well. We're on number 4 over there. We've got a lot of volunteers today.
Mainly, but the person who you're really reaching for is the most casual viewer. That's your responsibility, is one-on-one with them, and that means that viewer could be very uneducated or very educated, and so, you know, you have to reach into some place.
All this work only for 2 years.
Well, everybody does temporary work.
The space well. You know, another good strength is that I seem to be able to put things in spaces in a way that that enhance the space and enhance the feeling of the sculpture. You know, to play things off and to gain knowledge about that space as I'm there. Not just know it when I come, but take its full measure as I start to work. Once I'm cast my lot, then I try to make the best of it.
It'll go inside that.
Go inside where?
So over here, see? It's your nearest thing.
Yeah.
See this one right in front of you? See?
Okay.
There's a certain fear of failure going on in there. You know, you think, I could fail. And in a way, that's one of the great things about doing this work. You're working in public, and there's a high chance of failure. You know, so, but that keeps everything fresh, where, you know, you can't say, oh, I've done that before, I know just what to do. You really don't know what you're doing half the time. So this is an exciting place to be for a sculptor. That means these pieces in here could be a bit shorter, because I've got already one tall thing to kind of, like, as a pivot for the show. As the tower is a kind of sense of containment, and the nest is a kind of sense of containment, then this has another kind of sense of containment. You can go in these little cabanas. There's a, you know, kind of a hint of some kind of village. And so then I had a feeling that I wanted a grouping of things, and maybe this line that went with the doodle, it didn't have to be a solid fence that hooked these things together. Maybe it could be a much more ethereal sense of something that kind of contained and surround it, and that there would be kind of this kind of protective flying line that went around the outside, and it adds a bit of dimension to the piece. When we had the 5 independent pieces, they look good, but also this kind of entanglement with almost the forest. You know, that these things are not only are they little huts, but they came from the forest, and the forest is actually kind of hooked to them as this kind of flying fence.
I
first contacted Patrick Dougherty about 3 years ago. I'd always liked his work. And when I emailed him, we started our communication from then on. But he was booked up about 3 years in the future, and our schedule was booked up at the museum, too. So finally, we got together about 3 years later for a site visit. I had seen Patrick's work before in a number of catalogs and in a number of different locations across the United States. And I was always very impressed with it. And that, coupled with the idea of our museum building, seemed to make a natural fit. So I invited Patrick to come and use the museum building as his palette for his show. After initially contacting Patrick, we got together and met on site, and he took a look at the building. And then we firmed up the plans to have a show at Grounds for Sculpture. And after that point, the first thing that Patrick does is visits the site for a 3-day visit, learning about the building, experiencing the space, and starting to formulate his plans about what to create in the space. Aside from the fact that I've always admired Patrick's work, I thought it would be a unique opportunity for Grounds for Sculpture to present its first artist in residence on site. So because of the size of the museum, Patrick felt he would need to do 3 residencies in one spot rather than one to make enough work to fill the museum. So we planned it for a 3-month period or a 12-week period. And during each 3-month residency, he created 1 or 2 new works for the museum. Unlike a lot of other artists, Patrick Dougherty doesn't create a lot of finalized drawings and plans and architectural drawings before he starts. So it was somewhat of a leap of faith to give Patrick the whole museum building. But after having seen his work in a number of other places, it wasn't that much of a leap after all, and I was very pleased with the result. Like with Jehuli, we gave him drawings for a year, and there was every little detail was decided on. But in this case, it was like, all right, Patrick goes to work, and I never saw, you know, anything until it was done. So, being that Patrick was the first artist in residence at Grounds for Sculpture, it gave a tremendous opportunity for our visitors to interact with him on a daily basis, as well as over 200 volunteers who helped him construct the actual sculptures. So Patrick's show is much more than just a sculpture show, because it's a process. It involved the efforts of not only himself, but many volunteers and the public. And I think that interaction that Patrick has with the public and with the volunteers is as important as the sculpture itself.
Forces of nature that are playing out on these things, and so these kind of pressure lines or flow lines or sense of movement is it kind of built into the, you know, just a little, and it's a bit of reflective, like in the tower over there, you have these kind of architectural detail, this little line that runs around, and you say, oh, that's architecture. You've got this other kind of flying line, and you say, oh, that's nature. Or that's pressure, that's flow, that's some kind of a you know, natural phenomena. So to try to build something in that's both forest and habitat, you know, a wild place and kind of a comforting place for your viewer to go in, a bit of respite, you know. I think a good sculpture is one that causes a large number of associations in the viewer, that's just not a single one line come up when you look at it. And so that's what I hope that this piece and these things as a group of pieces, you know, that they have some kind of resonance for the viewer, that they're thinking about their childhood or a favorite tree that they played with. Oh, that's Mr. Twister. We've all played on that. You know, large numbers, succeeding numbers of children have played on that, or Simple, Hard, and Easy, the tree in our yard where you, as a child, you got to do the different parts of it, you know. So one of the things that, as I'm working often, people are talking to me always and constantly about the trees they've known. And, the lilac bush we played under, or I saw this in National Geographic, or I just saw this bird nest in on my back porch. You know, and so they're resonating with lots of phenomena in the world, I think driven by, in some sense, the loss of species and the the new interest in the environment is kind of driving underlying interest in it. And people are more interested in their gardens. You know, there's been a loss of agrarian life in the sense that you can't go visit your grandfather's farm anymore. So gardens like grounds for sculpture become much more essential places because they're substituting for kind of farm life and seeing growth and, you know, and being able to get in touch with something that's really crucial, and that is that we can just stand in a natural place and draw a great deal of sustenance from it and feel more human in some ways, and then play off of things that I see out of my peripheral vision. Sometimes I'll look around after I'm finished and I'll say, oh, look at that tower top. I just reproduced it. I didn't realize that. And I didn't realize, oh, and just pulling in lots of maybe architectural elements.
Over and under, pretty soon you lock it up as this kind of a strong.
It means not just falling over because everybody can pull that off, but that you're still, it feels good to the public and that they're still causing a lot of stirring feelings in them, you know. Working on the sphere down there, but then that's an even another kind of enclosure. And one of the things that I was interested in there is to try to attach it to the floor in a different way. So what we did is take these big pieces of granite, we set them on some 4x4s, we stuck a lot of sticks in under them like this, we bent the sticks up like this and got them to stay there, and then put a top on that, and then, you know, took everything apart. And so far it's holding, but you know, that sense of enclosure where the sticks tend to come in underneath your feet. So here you have, you're walking in, you know, you have a solid floor under your feet, and there the sticks kind of dive in under your feet in some way. So it gives an entirely different feeling. So I wanted to speak to a minute about the work being temporary, because I think that's a great concern for people. You say, well, what's going to happen to it? Well, maybe one or two of these things can be dragged outside and set up somewhere as a kind of a remembrance of it, but the majority of it is destroyed. And, you know, the thing, for me, I'm really a lot about process, and I love the piece I'm working on, and I let the pieces that I'm finished go, just like everybody does. Part of the world of ideas, every sculpture out here at Grounds for Sculpture is tied into some idea pool. And it's some of them are about the 20th century or maybe into the future. But, you know, I love being tied into everybody's thinking about some of their more tentative thoughts and some of their better feelings and the better side of human nature.
Hey, it's a nasty job. Somebody's got to do it.
Yeah. That's better. That's better, yeah.
This is the best yet.
They're all temporary work that you're doing. So, so am I. And so I'm very intense about the work that I'm doing. One of the mitigating circumstances is that I'm often allowed to use wonderful spaces if I'm willing to give the space back. And in public situations, all those spaces generally have to be negotiated with the public. But if you're going to do something for a year or 6 months or 2 years or whatever, you usually get by with it. We started out thinking that we were going to have a skylight in it, a big oculus in the ceiling like we did in the tower. But slowly, we loved the way that the dome looked, I mean, that we'd made a fairly good sphere. So we said, let's not sacrifice that. What we'll do is go in and put a hard ring around the upper part, kind of describing an oculus, but have this kind of stick sky in there. So we wouldn't make it too dark, but we'd have the best of both possible worlds. You could see it from outside, but you'd also have the sense of a kind of interior. And in a way that it looks good because it's a scrim in which you're seeing the grounds for sculpture beyond it, but it kind of contains you in a special way and in a kind of complete enclosure type place.
I've been in the museum world and the education world for 35 years, and I have never worked with anyone who is so creative and who understands his process and is so relaxed with it that he can explain it to others. Most artists and many educators cannot explain their process. Patrick does, and he does it with patience and grace and a love for what he's doing and an appreciation for those with whom he's working.
Logic, the way Patrick involves the volunteers, the way he integrates suggestions from people that he is showing how he does his work, I think is a rare quality for artists. I certainly appreciated the opportunity, and everyone I've spoken to admires the work we've seen here. I think this is a huge success. The idea of contemporary modern sculpture certainly includes something as natural as wood. Joyce Kilmer, the famous New Jersey poet, said that only God can make a tree, but I guess humans like Patrick Dougherty can certainly take trees and make them into something wonderful. So I just want to thank Patrick, and I do appreciate the opportunity I received. Thanks again.
Because for me, I couldn't work as an artist in isolation where there's no knowledge of the viewer. I have to be really keyed into, because I feel like that I'm in a conversation.
Dress in the darkness, you will long rest from the insistence of her soft caress that leaves you spent and powerless. Oh, oh, she put